Okay. Hi everyone. I've just put a note up in this group chat, just asking you to download a file called Introductions in the workshop page in LMS. Don't need it right now, but would like to use it a bit later on. How are you all going?
Good, thanks, Martin. Yourself?
Yeah, I'm all right. I'm all right. In amongst it all. And how'd you go with this week's readings?
Yeah, they were good. I haven't quite finished them, but I found them, particularly the video about like the cult protectionism one, that was intense, you know. it was confronting in a good way, but you know.
Protectionism. Right. What was confronting for you?
I think because, I mean, you might be able to tell from my accent, but I'm not initially Australian, right? And right. So I didn't really quite know about
that history.
I knew about it like in theory, but to be confronted like with the actual cartoons and the writings, like the ideologies and how real and prominent that was in the foundations of it is, you know, it was powerful for what it was.
Yes, it's a confronting history. It's always interesting hearing prime ministers talk about these things, but let's not get lost there at this stage. I want to just share the screen for a few moments, he says, hopefully. Better get the right things up there. That's the one I want. Okay, so I'll just share this with you. It's sort of a funny thing. This is where this thing can get so clumsy, kind of moving through. Can you see the screen there?
Yep.
So it's so this was a screenshot that one of the students in the class shared with me yesterday, just speaking about how it speaks to the issues, you know, particularly with regards to the podcast and the documentary film coming out of the US. So I think my thanks to Sissy Engineer for that, because there were these reflections coming up about Father's Day and slightly unusual ones, I guess, for those of us who've lived far more settled lives. Even as a migrant, I can't really place myself into this category at all. But those who didn't have a roadmap, trying their best, the ones who never look back in order to create a life where we can intentionally make choices they never had. Because the focus was very much on fathers in those two documentaries, and it's kind of interesting it coincides around Father's Day. I asked, inviting you to reflect upon that, I also asked you to think about, you know, does this kind of situation, the kinds of stories we've just heard, apply to Australia? And I was reminded straight away of the story in the very first week that came from the Radio National program AM, the current affairs that happens at 8 o'clock and 7 o'clock in the mornings. And there was this story about what happens to workers who lose their job while on a visa scheme. And this is about a couple of Fijian men who came here to work in abattoirs, doing obviously low paid work, risky work, got damaged in various ways. One of them had a very bad foot that wouldn't heal, and another had cut his hand and was infected as well. So they were really struggling in various ways and didn't turn up for work one day. But they didn't feel they could phone in sick because they'd get sacked. That was kind of the stuff going on with that. And in the end, they ended up in Melbourne. They didn't feel like the company was listening to them very well. There was some conciliation in the end around it, and they were reinstated into a place in another workplace. But the workplace, from the way they described it, certainly sounded horrendous in all sorts of ways. And these, of course, people who are here on temporary visas, and that's a new move, relatively new move in Australia. Migration to Australia for a good part of our history here has been a history of settlement migration. This has been settler migration nation. It's only in recent times that temporary visas, work visas, which really are guest worker schemes in many ways. People from the Pacific, backpackers as well, become part of that. They're in a different kind of situation. It harks back to earlier times when people from the Pacific were loaded onto boats and brought here in a period in Australia's history where people were used, again, for very low wages, if they were paid wages, and blackbirding is how that was phrased and framed in those days. Okay. What I want to do is just share with you one particular quote. I want to move on to ideas around the sociological imagination. And you may remember that C. Wright Mills is the person who coined the phrase. It's certainly attributed to him way back in the 1950s. And this is a quote that I think captures a good part of it. Neither the life of an individual nor the history of society can be understood without understanding both. And part of what I'm trying to encourage you to think about in this is how those migration stories that you've just encountered, hopefully, through the video, through that documentary made by The New Yorker, and, you know, so the intimate life, an intimate look at a farmer's divided life for the... And then the Carla Cornejo Villavicencio's piece about "I Can't Be Your Hero, Babe." They're both, I think, believe capturing some of that. Now, I'm just wondering, when you think about the notion of sociological imagination, so this is something you could contribute through the chat, or just I'll throw it open for comment. But when you think about the sociological imagination, what kind of key phrases or words or ideas come to mind that help explain it, that help put it into perspective? Key phrases, words, ideas. What comes to mind for you? Sacrifice. Thanks, Lauren. Anybody want to throw any into the mix just out loud? Bigger picture. Interrelationships, right? Empathy, yeah, interconnection. It's interesting when we start to think about that, because to some extent, I wonder about future building. I wonder about the degree to which these could also be applied into, say, a psychological imagination. I wonder if there's ways of just thinking about how a sociological imagination might be doing some different things. So a word I would want to throw straight in is structure. Is understanding that lives happen in patterns, that lives are subject to structures, you know, to social structure. Thanks again, your mic's not working, Rachel, sorry to hear that. Taking a new perspective. So I think that that's a really important part of it. I would be throwing in then structure agency, with those two holding together. And a key phrase from Mills himself is that individual problems are social issues. Individual problems are social issues. I would actually say that individual achievements are also social issues. We don't achieve without a social structure actually creating that achievement. Achievements don't actually exist without them. Is what I would be suggesting to you. You know, we are structured to make things happen, to do things through those through various mechanisms. You think about how school works, for example, in that regard, and the way in which it rewards certain behaviours, punishes others, those kinds of things. Which again, we can take psychological slants on, but they're producing very social effects. A sense of somebody who deserves to achieve as they've done to get where they've got to, and others who can be left feeling really quite humiliated through their schooling because they weren't able to achieve in those particular ways. That's the kind of insight that I believe that Mills' work is taking us to. The personal is political. That's actually that's an interesting one, Catherine. Thanks for that. Okay, I suggested an exercise where we have a look at both of those pieces, the film and the podcast. I'm wondering how you react, how you responded, what they did to you. I know that I was listening to Villavincenzi's actually live on the radio while I was preparing Sunday dinner, and it just stopped me in my tracks for some time. It was it is such a kind of angry piece, but such an eloquent summary of so many of the issues that go on. And obviously through that personal life, we see the bigger frame. I guess that's another one that we could throw into it, is the great is found in the small. The great is found in the small is perhaps another way of thinking through that idea of the sociological imagination. But I'm just wondering, when you think about the documentary film, An Intimate Look at a Farm Worker's Divided Life, what sort of issues could we identify in there, or what sort of phenomenon, individual experiences could we pick at and say, okay, well, we could have a look. I mean, I presume some of you have done the exercise. What did you use to do that exercise? You know, what parts of his life did you pick off? Anybody care to share that? Parents sacrificing for children. He's not getting educated himself. So sacrifice again comes up there. Yeah. So we could pick off, we could have a look at that. Anybody else want to just add anything in there? And feel again free to say it out loud. Intergenerational trauma, poverty running down bloodline. Parents sacrificing for children, isn't it? Okay, so that the politicizing excess is very loaded, and society does that to many people from disadvantaged backgrounds. Yep, yes. Yes, and of course, raise up those who do achieve and succeed. And we don't say much about, actually, the probability of that is much, much smaller than probably we'd like to think it is. And the people who don't make it in the same way don't get that same valorization. Let me just throw one at you. Let's see if we can unpack it. So at the very end of the commentary on the documentary film in the New Yorker website, they talk about how people don't necessarily realize how food reaches the table of families. So how food reaches the table of US families. So there is a personal phenomenon. Food on table. Now let's have a quick think about how it gets there. What's required to get that food on the table? And maybe we could throw into that at the price that we get it. So what's underpinning that? Come on, folks, let's hear from you. Cheap labor. You're being, I guess I've steered you into the chat. If you want to lower the price, you have to lower costs. Yeah, so putting the cost thing in does help, doesn't it? Anybody else got some thoughts? Franco?
I suppose as well that the food on the table is provided by people that aren't, you know, if we're talking about America, food is produced and made by people in America, but they're actually not from America. So it's this, I guess, this idea that we import people to do our dirty work, I guess, or the work that we're not really wanting to do.
Yeah. I found it interesting, Franca, that you're able to relate to the people. Have we got an image here of it's white folk getting the food on the table, and we relate to them through that, you know, that personal pronoun of we. Yeah. I mean, I guess it can also, we can say the same thing in Australia.
Yeah,
you know what cheap labour is doing out there, and we are hearing that from the farmers at the moment, with not allowing people in, it's going to get very difficult to get the crops in, and they're saying that, you know, we can't get Australian people to do this work. So yeah, it's not dissimilar. Rachel.
Yeah, the government's actually just announced a new initiative to try and get people to go to the regional areas. I think it's called Wander and Work. Yeah. wa.gov.au, just to address that very situation, actually.
Yeah.
Because without the backpackers coming through, it in particular, it's becoming a big problem to get some of that labour done on the farms.
Yep. Okay, we've had a few others added, benefiting off the struggles of others. And in America, we've got farming subsidies. Yep, which is not so much the reality in Australia. Okay, I guess the other thing that was worth... Sorry, Sophia?
No, it's right. My Wi-Fi is really bad around here, so sometimes it'll just cut people off, so I think there's silence, and then there's just not.
Okay, did you want to add something?
I was just going to say, like, particularly in America, though, it looks, seems like it applies for here and mostly everywhere. There's like this fear of immigration, but still willing to use the products of immigrants. You know what I mean?
Yeah, so there's a kind of railing against it, but at the same time, we're still eating the food that's on our table.
Yeah, it's very hypocritical.
And don't let those prices go up, because I'm going to be really angry with the government there as well. So there's a whole kind of pressure going on in the organization of society that we have to think through, and perhaps even own for ourselves as well, become, as I think, another issue in there. It's not just others. Who's there? The other thing that strikes me is it relies on poverty in the places that are the sending nations. You know, it doesn't happen without that. People ain't going to come unless there's unless the wages look very attractive. That's the comment from the Fijian guys in that radio piece that I talked about before. Sorry, I thought you were going to add something there, Sophia. No. No.
That's the thing, the wages comparatively for people in the upcoming and developing countries, the conversion rates is really what's making it worthwhile for them to come.
And it's obviously
that in and of itself is a problem.
Yeah, and of course I think the Mexican film, that film shows, does it not, just you know, in terms of what they've been able to achieve because of the sacrifice made by the father, whose name is escaping me right now, which I'm always so
Winnie.
Terrible at. Yeah, Winnie, yeah, yeah. All right, I can't be a hero, baby. What ones could we throw in there?
Thank you for including that, Martin, because that was actually a really enlightening and really wonderful to see that from a very different perspective than is often presented, as she rightly points out. I thought that was a really great piece. Thank you for including it.
Thanks, Rachel. I can't tell you how much I nearly threw them both out because I was trying to think, I can't get them to sit together. But in the end, I knew I had to share that one. When I heard it, I knew I had to share it. It was just that sort of feeling with it. And it also introduces you to this American life. And if you don't know it, know it. It's really it's a fascinating program, full of sociology, anthropology. But let's get away from that. What are some of the things that Carla Villavincenzi picks up that, you know, could reflect on? You know, some of the stories of her dad's life in particular, but her parents' life, her life. That, you know, so the individual aspects of their lives.
That attention to fear and the turmoil that's experienced, particularly with regards to the children that don't have that safety and the damage that it does have in the separation between parents and families.
Yes.
I mean, that's been proven without doubt, you know, I think quite conclusively. And I'd be fairly happy to do some quick research and dig up links to research on that, because it's something of interest for me. Mm-hmm. But that's such a strong link there between the need for the stability of the family and then expecting these kids who have spent literally decades in a country that they consider home, and that they could be deported essentially at a moment's notice, is quite horrific to think about, actually.
Yep. I mean, one of the notes I made was you could easily think about leaving your child behind in Ecuador when entering illegally into the US. You know, as a very specific decision, choice taken by parents. Choice is always, of course, in inverted commas to an extent. It is a choice. They could have chosen to stay with the debts that they had. Of course they could have. But there's no easy choice in that, is there? You know, this is the thing. So they make that move. And I can imagine many of us who sit, you know, somebody is in my situation finding it's hard to understand how you could possibly do that. how could you possibly leave your child behind like that? And I think that that's where, you know, trying to understand that through the structural lenses, the ways in which poverty works, the ways in which debt works, probably be another
thing. Martin, I think it's a big sense of survival as well. As much as we try to anthropologically and psychologically define certain aspects of behavior, it comes down to the very simple aspect of survival. Mm. If I cannot feed my child in a way, I'm going to leave them alone. And as much as I don't want to, I am forced by structural systems that go way beyond my power. So I need to survive, because I think it's a sense of adaptation, isn't it?
Mm-hmm. Sure. Yeah, survival is...
I'd also argue there too, Martin, to some extent, that your hesitation there isn't of itself a different reading than those parents would have had of the situation, because you now have the benefit of an education that tells you that that separation is detrimental to a child's development. But if you have the choice between going and earning money to pay off your debt so your child can go to school, or not in that situation, bearing in mind the time frame in which we're talking there, which I think was about the 90s, when a lot of this research was still new and upcoming, before a lot of people, you know, seemed to be starting to take a real interest in the research and academic field. I think really the choice is not maybe quite so, you know, it probably seemed quite obvious. I mean, the child's with family, that she's safe. She's not doing a dangerous border crossing. They go there for a year and then they realise they can't afford to come back. I think the initial decision probably seemed to be a very wise choice to them at the time.
Yeah, pretty straightforward. Maybe, well, yes, kind of. I still can't imagine what it's like to do it, but yes, yep. Will, did you want to add anything to yours? It's a little bit ambiguous. Damn urban privileged young people grew. Did you want to add anything?
That was just added on top of the whole state government doing they're trying to incentivize moving and doing some work in the towns, but obviously it's always done for the low wages by
owners. Yes. Yep. Yeah. And you know, I always think about this because this comes up from generation to generation. I remember it happening 20 years ago, complaints about young people not being willing to move to the Northwest where there was so much work and unemployment down in South Victoria. Why won't they go? Because that's where their family is. Because that's where their friends are. Because that's where their lives are being lived. And 75% of Australians live in cities. It structurates our lives in significant ways, you know, those kind of things. They're not small, the people's
lives.
Have
it too good.
Hmm?
We've been living in abundance our whole lives and we don't know what suffering is. So the old people just want us to go and work on a farm for a bit.
Yeah, sure. And there's something in that argument. Anyway, let's not get lost there. The whole go back to where you came from rhetoric is super reductive and ignorant. And thanks again. Look, we could keep going now. I mean, I just, the other one I signaled was becoming a delivery boy in New York. When her dad had to go from being an affluent taxi driver, to becoming, you know, a delivery boy because of what happened on the 9/11, as we have come to call it, and the ways in which legislation then shifted and really put pressure on the undocumented. So you can see there's so much going on in that story that's worth, that I think is important for us to understand. I'm just going to share one more bit from here, and this is coming from Carla herself, who's written a book called The Undocumented Americans. I tried to get hold of it the other day through my usual provider. They don't have it. You can get it through Amazon. And here's something. This is at the end. This is a review in the New York Times. Many of us are indigenous in part or whole and do not believe borders should exist. Bill of Vincentio writes, I personally subscribe to Dr. King's definition of an unjust law as being out of harmony with the moral law. And the higher moral law here is that people have a human right to move, to change location if they experience hunger, poverty, violence, or a lack of opportunity. Now here comes the big one, the big sweeping claim, especially if that climate in their home countries is created by the United States, as is the case with most third world countries from which people migrate. Ain't that about a bitch? She does write in here, actually, Rachel, the neurology of separation from parents. So she does actually look into some of that research that you were talking about earlier. Okay. Abolish borders. Now there's a debate for us, isn't it? We have a right to determine who will come to this country under what conditions, said Prime Minister Howard many years ago when he was in some electoral trouble and he managed to scrape through that particular problem for himself by thickening the Australian borders. Well, that was certainly one of the things that caused it. But it would be a very interesting debate to have. I'm not going to try and do it now. But I want to now go to SA. I now want to have a bit of a think about that and how we can and do some workshopping around it. And I notice that most of you have decided on the essay. Those of you who haven't, I presume that it's going to be still okay, worthwhile going into this exercise. There's two things I basically want to do. I want to give you a further opportunity, and I know I gave this to you last week in the tutorials, but hopefully each iteration moves things along. Before I go any further, let me just, yes, it's difficult to debate borders with a pandemic. That's true, Rachel, but we are debating them. My God, we're debating them, aren't we? But particularly internally, it's a very significant one. And it's got big economic structural issues at play, as well as family and all those things. Isabella, the overarching minority student ambition is celebrated by white Americans without the context of the fear of deportation and poverty that fuels it. Yeah, thanks. Yep, if you want to get rid of borders, you have to get rid of all welfare too. Can't have both. There you go. The debate, the debate can start. I'm not gonna go there, but thanks, Callum. And I'm sure there'll be some responses to that in some ways. What I want to do with the essay is this. Give you an opportunity just to get us, just capture where you're at with it. And I think this will be worthwhile doing next week as well. I won't be able to run a workshop the week after, by the way. I'll have to cancel that particular one, but I'll put a notice about that soon. What then I want to do is this. I've already signaled to you that I asked you to come prepared to at least deal with these questions, but I'll put them up. Let me make sure. Okay, it looks like that's okay. So I'll just put that up. The question I'm going to tackle and why, what the question is asking me to do, the sources I've located so far and the examples I'm going to use, the argument I want to make. I'm not assuming you're very far advanced with this. I'm just seeing where you've got to, and I'm not seeing an opportunity to get a sense yourselves of where you're up to and where others are up to. And I just want to pop you into a room for, where are we at? Yeah, 5 minutes or so. There is another thing that I do want to, there's another exercise, and that's, I want to look at introductions to essays. I want to have a bit of a think about that. So I'm going to create ten rooms. That'll get you into twos and threes. I'm going to open them up. The chance to talk one-on-one or in threes around your essay choice, how it's going. If you're struggling with it, there's a chance to talk through that a bit too. See you in five.
Hi, Martin. My laptop crashed, and so I exited the meeting. But
do you know where you were?
I was in breakout room 5.
Okay, I'll send you back there if that's all right.
Thank you.
Was it a useful place to be in?
Yes.
Okay, you're going in now.
Awesome.
Thanks, Catherine. Isabella, bloody hell. Welcome back, Isabel.
I'm back. Very informative 2 minutes.
Did you try to adjust back into it? Yeah. I think we're back. There might be one group still to join, hard to tell. All right, any questions? Anything anybody needs to ask at this stage?
I have a question, Martin, but I think it might be better like on a one-on-one session.
All right, yep. Yep, maybe. I mean, what is it in general, Catherine?
Well, I've chosen question number 8 about Australia building a multicultural society, but I'm sort of struggling on whether the migrant group I've chosen is considered a migrant group.
All right. Okay. All right. Well, okay. We'll talk about that at some point. Considered a migrant group. Okay. We'll talk about that maybe straight after, if you like. Anybody else?
Yeah. When it refers to a case study in actually that exact same question, does it refer to like a documentary from ABC or SBS? Would that count as a case study, or should it be like a research paper?
I think you could do both. I mean, I think that's fine. I mean, obviously we're using documentaries to present our case studies, so I think that's fine. Just obviously make sure you can reference it and so on. But do try to connect to sociologist, anthropologist writing in the area. I mean, it doesn't have to be specifically about that case study, but you do need to connect it to more general theory as well. I mean, so you can see how you can use the example, you know, the film we've just seen, the podcast we've just heard, would be something you could certainly use as data, and then just connecting it into the ideas, the broad theory. Anybody else? I will give several pieces of advice along the way, but my one for today really is you need to see yourself as the person in control of your essay. The essay should not control you. You need to control the debate that you are going to enter into, the discussion, the argument that you're putting forward, and need to be clear about that. People can get overwhelmed. It's a very small space to write in. There's all these other things to write about, and if I don't do it, I might look like I'm ignoring them. Well, don't ignore them. Say that you're aware of it. You know, I'm aware that if I think about educational success amongst migrant groups, I'm aware that language is one factor. I'm aware that social class is another. I'm aware that family background is significant here. You know, you could start to list off the different things, but for this essay, I'm going to focus on gender and what it does. You know, so you just, you cite some sources that you show that you've done, you've picked up some, you know that there's a debate and an argument. I know it's there, but I'm not doing that. This is the one I'm doing. And this is what I'll focus on. So you guess that's, it's a kind of funnel metaphor. So I think that's an important part of it. I don't want to get, I'll leave that at now because there's another exercise I want you to do. I've asked you to download the introductions. Oh. Is somebody trying to get through there or is that just a unmuted mic? Let me just share, I want to share a screen. I want to share the screen a little bit and a couple of things I want to show you. So the first thing I want to show you is the rubric that we'll be using for the essay or something close to it. Hang on, what are you doing? Can you see that screen? I don't think that's... here we go. It's disappeared down. All right. Let me show you this. So this is the, that's a bit off screen, isn't it? Can you see this, at least in part? So it's an ad, 1002 research app.
Yep.
And it's got introduction, but it only gets you to credit, doesn't it? Is that right? Yes. Or can you see the whole thing?
We can only see credit.
Yeah, okay. That's my bad, as usual. I'll stop the share.
Well, you should be able to drag it.
I'll get into here. That's right. No, I just need to do that. I need to do a bit of dragging of it if I can, although I don't think it's going to expose it. It's going to go bigger on me. Maybe I'll show it up the business end of it about the kind of things we're looking for in the essays and how we will sort of things, yeah, that we're looking for. Again, I don't want to get too lost in this stage because this is something you'll get to see anyway. We've got that you can see, it actually is moving, yeah? If I scroll up and down. So introduction, conclusion, you can get some ideas about the sort of things, but maybe you're looking for, you know, the essay can convey a sophisticated argument response critically to the question of the high degree of skill. The essay demonstrates a sophisticated critical understanding of relevant concepts used skillfully to develop the analysis, relevant and detailed examples that are used skillfully to support the main argument while demonstrating an awareness of their complexities and contradictions, those kinds of things. And the analysis is incorporated skillfully, reflecting critically on the issues raised by the examples and the sources used. Demonstrating original insights, something moving in that direction at least. PhDs are meant to be the original contributions to knowledge, but certainly ideas that we're not looking for you to be novel, but certainly to be engaging closely with it. Okay, I'll stop that share. What I want you to do is, have you been able to open up those introductions? Been able to open them up? I had a couple of yeses. I've got thumbs going up. It's okay.
Would you mind linking them again, please? Sorry, Martin. It didn't come
up. Well, it's in the introduction from the workshop panel in LMS.
Thank you.
If you go into there, you should be able to find it. All right. I'm going to drop. What I'm going to ask you to do is to read them. And I just want to show you. I just want to summarize here. You might want to get a screenshot of this. Can you see it? Yes, this is now just the rubric that I'm using for the introduction. Can you see that?
Yes, we can.
Okay. So there's the categories. No pass, pass, credit, distinction, high distinction. So you can see what we're looking for. Essay thesis relevant, clearly outlined, openings engaging and original. Maybe get a screenshot of those. I'm going to drop you into the rooms for those few minutes. Have a read through them. Have a read through those introductions and see if you can make some sort of judgment about where you think they sit. They are variant. They are variable. They do have different They do have different grades. They are past papers and they're genuine past papers. And I'm going to drop you in.
So where are the introductions on LMS? I don't see.
They're in the workshop panel in the LMS.
Where's the workshop panel?
Sorry. Down the left-hand side, you should see workshop. When you land in on it.
I can't see anything on the panel.
Martin, I'm seeing this the same in the research essay at the bottom. You've got the whole structure there in LMS. So you got the same, the introduction.
Okay, look, I'm sorry. This is,
I found them under workshop details. And then it says like workshop recordings, a set of three introductions written by students.
Yep. It's right at the very, it's if you just scroll down that little bit into where their section is. I'll just see if I can locate it for you. But it's the time's running fast on us, I'm afraid.
Yep, found them.
Yep. So that's what the page looks like, the workshop details. And they're just as you go down a little bit further, written by students in past years. I reckon what all you'll get time to do is maybe the first one, just get some sense of where that's at. I'll drop you into the room, see how you go. And it can be an ongoing exercise. If you've got to go, you've got to go. We can always extend the time that little bit. Okay, six rooms. And I'll drop in as best I can for a few moments, if I can, some of them at least. Okay, should be able to open them now. So there's some writing.
Yeah, there is.
some things to emulate or not, as the case may be.
Yeah. What were the? Can we have like the questions for the different?
Well, instructions? I mean, one of them was about, you know, McDonaldize was actually a direct question about McDonaldization. The other was is McDonaldization a valid way of describing, you know, globalization? There was one about the scapes, which I think the person shaped into thinking about technoscapes. So I think they were invited to reflect on the scapes idea. And the what was the second one? Yeah, that I can't remember exactly. I could try and find them, Jonathan. I could find the questions for you and put them up to make those links, if that helps. Okay. Any quick thoughts, reactions to that? Can I? The thing I will say before we start is, I often find students much harsher than I am in judging each other's work. particularly when it can be done in that objective way, when it's not anybody you know, when it's not somebody in the room with you. They tend to get really kind of, I've noticed it there as a general trend. But any thoughts, any responses to what you've just been reading? I will share the grading with you in a moment. If we think about the first one.
Our group couldn't spot a thesis in it.
The first one, you couldn't spot a thesis?
Yeah.
I would say the thesis statement is the last sentence.
Yeah.
Yeah, I agree. Also, I thought it was the last sentence too.
Last sentence. And it's almost like the conclusion's already been given to us. I thought they could have actually shortened that bit. You still say what your argument is, because the argument is there and it is the last statement, I think. But it almost felt like, some of that could have been spent in the conclusion, I suspect. Would have been more productive that way. We'll always remember that we do all write a bit differently. that first one got graded, so you know, it got graded as a distinction. So it got a 74. I'll actually put the other ones up because we are reaching, we have gone past our time. The second one, actually, I mean, I had not assessed those papers, but when I just looked at them yesterday, I thought, oh yeah, that looks, actually, it's not a bad reflection about where it would go. The first one would really have to tighten up to get into the distinction category for me, but I suspect that the person was going to get there. The third person really didn't have a great clarity, I don't think, around where they were going. Anyway, comes out in that way. Look, folks, we could take that a bit further, and next week I will give more time in the workshop to thinking about the essay. We are going to be focused on migration. We're going to be focused on a case study of Chinese migration in Australia, and I probably will give some attention to some multiple choice questions as well, and we'll come then to the to pushing the essays further. Something I'd really encourage you to do is to have a go at writing those first few lines as an initial draft to your work, just to say, so you can start to capture it in writing. If we could start sharing stuff like that, I think it can really push us along. It's a good structurating force to be accountable to some work into the classroom. Any other questions anybody would like to ask about essay writing or about what you've just done?
Oh, I find it very helpful to look at other students' examples, so thank you.
Yeah, welcome. We'll do a bit more of that as well.
It seems like introduction number 2, which got marked 90%, has a very strong position.
Yeah, it's very clear. Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah, I think so. And look how short it is. it's another important part of it. It's often very difficult. I'll talk more about that next week. Anything else?
What was wrong with the third one?
I'd have to go back to specifics. Anybody got any thoughts on their response to the third one?
It's not clear where the thesis statement is and where the direction.
Yeah, I think there's a lot of generality going on in it. It doesn't get to a specific point. That's that funnel idea. Getting down to, this is what my argument is. This is where I'm going with this essay. And you cannot do everything. It's really important to keep that in mind. And I find that really difficult when I'm writing. I have such a strong commitment to holism. And it is a bit of a trap. But you've got to find ways of managing that. Okay. And when we say what's wrong with it, let's remember it's got a good solid credit. That's not bad. Okay. We'll see you in class, many of you, and see you next week for the workshop.
Bye.
Bye now.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Yes, Catherine, that's fine.
Thank you.
So, everyone. Hi, Matthew. Do you mind stopping the recording for now?
Oh, good God.